Hello and welcome to this Science Museum online event. I'm Roger Highfield, Science Director of the Science Museum Group, and with me are the New York Times best-selling science writer Jo Marchant and the Astronomer Royal Lord Martin Rees. I should also say that though this is a virtual event, the Science Museum and all our four sister museums are very much open. We're here to discuss Jo's latest book, The Human Cosmos, which tells the story of humanity's relationship with the cosmos, how that relationship has evolved, and perhaps most extraordinary of all, how our view of the stars permeates every aspect of society, from religion to capitalism and politics. Now, if you're watching live, you can get hold of a copy by clicking on the link in the description below, while stocks last, of course. And after brief introductions, Jo will read some short extracts to prompt our discussions. And halfway through, we'll be taking your questions. So do ping them over via the chat box. We'd love to hear from you all. So first, let me welcome Lord Rees, a great friend of the museum, who's written many fine books from On Our Future to Our Final Hour and Gravity's Fatal Attraction, a new edition of which is out in October and also available for pre-order now. Jo, we used to work together at New Scientist, and I can well remember when you decided you wanted to write books full time. And I must admit, I was a bit crestfallen at the time since we were losing such a good journalist, but what a great decision that proved to be. So congratulations on The Human Cosmos. And I think without any further ado, Jo, let's hear your first extract from the book.
Thanks, Roger. So I wanted to start with two mini readings, each describing a different view of the stars. When NASA astronaut Chris Hadfield climbed out of the International Space Station for his first spacewalk in April 2001, it was the culmination of decades of training and preparation. A hard-headed, disciplined pilot, Hadfield had studied maths, physics, engineering, and robotics. He had flown over 70 different types of aircraft. He had spent 50 full days practicing spacewalks in the pool. "I was completely technically prepared for what was going to happen," he says. And yet, in a sense, he wasn't prepared at all. When he first floated free in the vacuum of space, holding onto the spaceship with one hand, all thoughts of his mission to prepare a 17-meter long robotic arm for installation temporarily left his head. Instead, he was attacked by raw beauty. To his right was the velvet, bottomless bucket of the universe, stretching on forever and brimming with stars. And to his left, the whole world, an exploding kaleidoscope of color, poured by. "It was stupefying," he said later. "It stops your thought." Alone in his spacesuit, looking down on 6 billion people and all of the history, all of the beauty and poetry and everything else that is human, Hadfield says he learned something in that moment that a lifetime of books, lectures, and calculations have been unable to teach. "The power of the presence of the world, as told to me by my ability to see it." And the other one. "A few summers ago, on a feature assignment, I found myself in a tiny one-person tent, sheltering from a violent thunderstorm in the remote mountains of Mexico. When the rain finally stopped, I squeezed out into the night. I felt anxious and alone until I looked up and was hit by a rush of adrenaline. Above me was a radiant, shimmering sea, an ocean of light that stretched not just from horizon to horizon, but deep into forever. For a brief moment, I was lifted up, connected, home." Thinking back, it isn't the individual constellations I remember, or the planets, or even the glittering ribbon of the Milky Way. It is simply the sheer, awesome power of the sky. In London, where I live, the night sky is dull and dark with a neon orange glow, its emptiness broken only by a few struggling pinpricks of light. But here, the veil was lifted, as if returning to me something that I hadn't even known was lost. On this moonless night, it seemed there was no blackness at all. There was only silver, only stars. And I chose those because one of the things that motivated me to write The Human Cosmos is that societies all through history have experienced this mind-blowing view of our universe. Until now, we're the first people not to have that view of the stars readily available to us. So in our cities, instead of thousands of stars, we can now see only a few dozen. 80% of us in the US and Europe can't even see the Milky Way. And that's important because the awe that we feel when the stars literally stop our thought has some really profound psychological effects. Research shows that that awe makes people more curious and more creative, less stressed, but also they become nicer people. People make more ethical decisions. They're more likely to make sacrifices to help others. They care less about money, more about the planet. They feel more connected to others. So we've built this wonderful scientific view of the universe. But I think that maybe we're also at the same time losing something important. So this book is really about how our view of the stars has inspired and guided people through history and why I think that's still important today.
So Martin, what's your take on that particular story? You know, where does our fascination with the stars come from the viewpoint of the Astronomer Royal? And in fact, tell me about your own personal fascination with the stars as well. When you were wearing short trousers, what got you interested in the night sky?
Let me answer your first question. The important thing about the night sky is it's one feature of our environment that's been shared by all people all over the world throughout human history. So it's one thing that we all have in common. Different cultures have interpreted it in different ways, and Jo's book is emphasizing how this has changed from prehistoric times almost to the present. But it's a feature of our environment, which is common to us all. And that's why I completely agree with Jo how sad it is that we can't see it clearly. Dark skies campaigns are very important, and it's important that they're not just for astronomers. It's not just astronomers who miss seeing a night sky, just as you don't have to be an ornithologist to miss the singing birds in your garden. So they're part of nature and they're crucially important to preserve. And Jo's book shows how different generations have interpreted them differently.
And Martin, what was your original cosmic epiphany, as it were? Yes.
Well, I made a really late start. I was very keen as a kid for big numbers and nature generally. But I only got into astronomy by accident much later, really, because I was good at maths and I studied math at university, and I decided I didn't like it. And so I tried to find something where I could apply my knowledge of it to something that got my enthusiasm. And I was actually very lucky, because this is back in the mid-1960s, which was an exciting time when astronomy was going through a big surge. First evidence of the Big Bang and black holes and all that. And I was lucky to be one of the young people to help with these developments. And I always tell any young people who are listening to us now, if you're going to do research, pick a subject where new things are happening. Otherwise you'd be doing the things the old guys got stuck on, but you could do things that they never had a chance to do.
I've got to admit, Jo, I've got a terrible confession in that I was raised in London, and I only discovered the night sky in my late 20s. And I was staying, would you believe it, a desert camp just south of Namibia, and where you just get the most spectacular view of the heavens and you realize what you've been missing in London. How damaging do you think it is, Jo, that we're denied this natural spectacle in the big city?
I think it is really damaging. And I think that it's something that's been hard to articulate and to quantify. So when we hear about dark skies, we do sometimes hear the perspective from astronomers with light pollution affecting observations. And I think Martin's absolutely right that this is something for everybody, that cultural heritage, that this is something that everybody has shared. But also that research on awe, I think, is really important because it helps us to get at why that view is so inspirational and so important. That it, you know, we have our brilliant scientific understanding, but that personal connection, that feeling, that sort of thought-stopping moment when we come into contact with a truly dark sky, which I think it's so easy to forget what that's like, or to never have experienced what that's like. You know, we go to the countryside and we think we've seen the stars, but then when you see a truly dark sky, it's absolutely mind-blowing, and it does change how people think. It makes us feel more connected to a bigger picture, and as I was saying, people make more ethical decisions, they care more about the planet. So I think it's really important, especially with the climate crisis that we're facing now, that we have access to that. I think that we should absolutely see it as a crucial part of nature and of our history that we should be really fighting to save.
Jo, let's have your next reading and then let's have a chat after that as well.
Okay, so I tried to put as many stories as possible into the book. So this is a story of a big discovery. On 12th September 1940, 17-year-old Marcel Rabadin, an apprentice mechanic, walked with three friends into the hills near his village of Montignac in southwest France. According to village legend, there were caves beneath the hills, and Rabadin wondered if they might hold treasure. A few days before, he had started to unblock a promising hole in the ground. Now, armed with a knife and a makeshift lantern, he planned to finish the job. The boy's target was a basin-shaped depression in the ground, surrounded by pine trees and junipers and full of brambles. At the bottom was a small opening that led to a narrow, near vertical shaft. The boys cleared the thorns and the remains of a donkey and dug with their hands to widen the hole to about 30 centimeters across. They dropped down stones and were surprised by how long they rolled and the resonance of the sound. Those brambles had been hiding something big. Rabadin, the oldest and strongest of the group, dived in headfirst and wriggled several meters through the earth before landing on a conical pile of clay and stones. He lit his lamp, which he'd made from a grease pump and a coil of string, but almost immediately lost his balance and slipped all the way to the bottom. He found himself in a large hall, about 20 meters long, and called for his friends to follow. They crossed the limestone cavern in near darkness, dodging shallow pools of water on the floor, until they reached a narrow corridor with a high arched ceiling like a cathedral vault. Only here did Rabadin raise his lamp, and the boys found their treasure. Covering the white walls was an explosion of life. Images from the birth of our species pulled back into view for the first time in 20,000 years. First, they noticed coloured lines and strange geometric signs. Then, moving the lamp around, they saw the animals. There were horses everywhere, golden with black manes, as well as black and red bulls, ibexes, and a bellowing antlered stag. Herds climbed the walls and tumbled across the ceiling, some defined and multicoloured, others ghostly, as if falling through fog. The boys didn't understand the full significance of what they had found, but they knew it was special, and they celebrated with leaps and cries in the trembling light. So they discovered Lascaux Cave, of course, in France, which is one of the most spectacular caves in terms of cave art from the Paleolithic, all covered with animals. And so it's clearly a celebration of nature, but there's also signs that it was also intended as a sort of a celebration of the sky as well. So I just wanted to show a couple of images. So the first one, hopefully you'll be able to see, is showing some collections of dots. So the top left one here is the Pleiades star cluster. And then the three black and white ones, these are images that we know are of the Pleiades from different traditional art around the planet, Native American societies from Siberia. We've got the Subaru car manufacturer's logo, which they've changed the pattern a little bit. But you can see this characteristic pattern that in different parts of the planet has been used to represent this star cluster. And then the bottom left here is the pattern of dots on the wall of Lascaux Cave. And then if we go to the next slide, which hopefully, there we go. Hopefully you can see that the right-hand picture, this shows you that those dots, interestingly, are above the shoulder of this huge Oryx bull. And the interesting thing about that is that the modern constellation Taurus, the Pleiades has the Pleiades at its shoulder. And so they're very similar. If you look at the horns, the prominent eye, the star Aldebaran, there's the speckles of the Hyades star cluster around the face. So it's led to this idea of, were they actually, rather than just painting animals, were they painting the stars? Did they see animals in the sky? And it's we can't know for sure what they were thinking, but there's some really interesting work from analysis of myths showing that some myths about the stars date back, the conclusion is, to the Paleolithic, where researchers have made sort of evolutionary trees of the development of myths. And also looking at hunter-gatherer communities today and recent communities and how they interact with the stars. And they very much see the rising and settings of the star constellations through the sky as intertwined with events in nature. So some Native American peoples, for example, see the Pleiades rise and setting through the year is entwined with the life cycle of the bison bull, which they hunt. So when the Pleiades set, it's time to hunt. So it's all building a picture of this primordial, I suppose, world view where there wasn't that separation between the earth and the sky. What was happening in the stars was seen as intimately connected with events in nature on Earth. And it's that sort of holistic cosmos, if you like, that I think we've been separating ourselves from ever since.
So what I found really fascinating about the LASSO images is that I was expecting, given that human beings are the most cooperative and social creatures of all, but if you look at the imagery on the caves, they would have been of other people. But in fact, it's animals, isn't it, that supremely dominates. What does that tell us about the way people thought at the time?
Yeah, it's really interesting, isn't it? It's almost exclusively animals. There are very occasional human figures in paleolithic art, but it's basically, and you also get hand stencils where people made images of their hands, but it's mostly about the animals. And archaeologists interpret that as, they really saw themselves as part of nature. And it's only really with the Neolithic, just ahead of the birth of agriculture, that you start to see human forms dominate. There's a fascinating site from the 10th millennium BC in Turkey, so just where farming was about to originate, just before stone circular enclosures with these stone pillars, these sort of human-like figures. And then there are carvings of animals, foxes, vultures, but they're very much subservient to these human figures. So it's very interesting that you see that kind of split with nature, suddenly these dominant human figures just ahead of the birth of farming and agriculture.
If we jump forward a few thousand years, you talk about the Babylonians using the stars to predict very predictable specific events, and they did this using mathematics. So how significant was that in the kind of evolution of the modern mind?
I think it was a really significant moment. So this is the first, when we have clay tablets from Mesopotamia, that's the first time we've really got written records to know what people thought. And so we have Babylonian tablets dating back to the third millennium BC. And this is really showing a society that was obsessed with the heavens. It's just thousands of omens to do with celestial events and what this was going to mean for the fate of the country and the king. So the king would have teams of astronomers who were recording what was happening in the skies every night. And because they were doing that every night, they started to see patterns in what was happening in the sky, and they started to use mathematics to come up with arithmetical models that could then describe these cycles they were seeing and to predict them. So that was the first time that we went from an analog cosmos, if you like, to a digital one, using the maths to predict accurately what was going to happen in the sky. And we often think of the Greeks as being the sort of the originators of astronomy, if you like, but it was that influence of the Babylonians with the mathematical models that really encouraged the Greeks that actually, yes, you can be accurate about your observations. So I think that was a really important moment that sort of allowed that sort of scientific endeavor going forwards.
I suppose you can also, though, see the link with astrology. I mean, of course, astrology is total bunkum, but you can understand why the ancients thought that the stars, in some sense, ruled their affairs, you know, given the link with agriculture and the seasons. So just talk me through about how interlinked were astronomy and astrology at that time.
Yeah, so at that time, there really was no difference between the two. It's hard to know which word to use because it was all bound up together. And you can totally understand why people thought in that way. I've talked about the sort of the rising and setting of the constellations at different times of year, correlating with different seasonal events on Earth. So for the ancient Egyptians, it was the appearance of the star Sirius that happened ahead of the flooding of the Nile, which was a crucially important event for them. For the Mayans, it was the appearance of Venus that heralded the rainy season. And so we would see no particular connection between those events. They just happened to occur at the same time. But for people in ancient times, it was very much all just one part of one interconnected system in which, you know, yeah, everything was connected with everything else.
So Martin, just bringing you in here, I've dealt with you over decades and I've heard you introduced, Martin, many times as the astrologer royal. What's your take between this ancient link between astrology and astronomy?
Yes, well, indeed, I'm sometimes asked, do I do the Queen's horoscopes? And I have to say, she's never asked me. And of course, early astronomers, even up to Kepler, they were employed more as astrologers than as astronomers. But I think the point that Joe's made is that the Babylonians collected data over many, many decades. And that's why they found these regularities and they could predict when eclipses were coming, etc. They didn't know the underlying mechanisms, but they understood regularities. And of course, this was important for the calendar. They had to understand what was happening in order to decide how long the year was and all that. And so astronomy, I like to say, was the first science, except perhaps for medicine, but certainly the first science to do more good than harm.
And Jo also talked there about the use of mathematics as a tool to kind of crystallize these heavenly regularities. If you wind forward to some very contemporary ideas about the heavens, some would even go as far as to say that the universe itself is a great mathematical structure. Math is the reality. What's your take on that?
Well, of course, maths is the tool for understanding the motions of the planets and stars. Newton told us this. And of course, for understanding all of physics. And there's a famous saying by the great physicist Eugene Wigner, where he has an article called The Unexpected Relevance of Mathematics to the Physical Sciences.
Was it the unexpected effectiveness of
mathematics in the physical sciences. And indeed, it is a puzzle, but of course, were that not the case, we couldn't make any predictions, we couldn't understand anything. But it's clear that mathematics is a tool. And if you think about modern science and future science, the question is, will the maths that's needed get too hard for human beings to understand? It's quite possible that the underlying theory of the universe, what we call a unified theory, may involve such difficult mathematics that we'll never be able to do it. So maths, of course, was stimulated by astronomy, and it was needed for navigation and, of course, for the calendar.
But Marty, you don't go as far as Max Tegmark and say that the universe itself is a mathematical entity.
No, I don't think that makes sense. I mean, that's sort of a philosophical speculation. But certainly, mathematics is what underlies and has to be used to explain everything that happens in the universe. But the math is often too hard for us to work out.
Let's go on to your next reading.
So this is another discovery, but this time one that was found in a medieval book. In the archives of Oxford University's Bodleian Library, there's a small but unusually chubby book, known simply as MS Ashmole 1796. It consists of around 200 pages of calfskin bound between leather-covered wooden boards. Written in the 14th century, its square black lettering is adorned with painted capitals and interspersed with neat diagrams, showing complicated mechanical arrangements of axles and wheels. The book was bequeathed to the university in the 17th century by the collector and astrology enthusiast Elias Ashmole, and lay unstudied for hundreds of years. In 1965, an Oxford astronomy historian named John North finally translated its Latin script and realized that hidden among these pages was something special, a description of a spectacular invention to which a monk called Richard of Wallingford, the abbot of St. Alban's Monastery from 1327 to 1335, dedicated much of his life. The invention was a colossal clock, installed high beneath the great south window of the abbey's church. But Richard's construction was no ordinary timekeeper. It was a sophisticated, self-moving model of the cosmos, unlike anything else known when it was built. And so far ahead of its time, that when the librarian and antiquity specialist John Leland saw it two centuries later, in 1534, he described it as a marvel still without equal in all of Europe. The clock demonstrated the workings of the universe, Leland said, from the oceans to the heavens. One may observe the course of the sun, the moon, or the fixed stars, or again, one may regard the rise and fall of the sea. No trace of the clock now remains, and for modern historians reading those words, it was hard to know what Leland really saw, until North realized in the Bodleian Library that he was holding Wallingford's instructions for building this very machine. The secrets he discovered reveal not just an impressive invention, but a crucial moment in human history. This chapter then tells the story of why and how the monks of medieval Europe chased down time, and how in doing so they transformed humanity. As we'll see, their efforts to track daily cycles ever more accurately were ultimately successful beyond their wildest dreams. Yet they also destroyed the very thing they pursued. Until this point in history, time was a sign of the divine cosmic order, as shown to us through the cycling motions of the sun, moon, and stars. The invention of mechanical clocks unleashed a very different kind of time, powerful enough to weaken our bond with both God and the universe and set the foundations for a new way of life. So we were talking about this trajectory where we're building this more scientific mathematical way of looking at the universe, and that the Babylonians being the first to use maths to model the motion of the heavens. And this is the moment that that happened with time, so that the first clocks were models of the universe, essentially, these complicated devices. I think there might be a picture of the world's clock that we can see.
That's right. We've got a lovely example in the Science Museum. You can hear the chimes of it. This is the mechanism of the Wells Cathedral clock. And of course, mechanical clocks go back to what, late 13th century. This mechanism is from 1390. And so the fact that it's still working is really remarkable. And obviously, Joe, we take it for granted that we can tell the time at any time. But just talk a little bit more about how the ability to independently measure time of the sun and so on. Why was that so significant? And what sort of changes did that exert on society?
Yeah, that's beautiful. Actually, sorry, this clock is I'm not sure whether this one did have an astronomical display. It looks like it was ringing the bells. But many of these early clocks from Wallingford onwards were modeled, they were trying to copy the movements of the cosmos, you like, these clocks. But eventually, as they became more accurate, they actually then transcended that. They became more accurate than the sun. And so time was then held not in the movements of the universe, but in our sort of mechanical clocks. And that did really change society in a few different ways that historians have cited as helping to lay the foundations for the modern industrial age of capitalism. So there was first of all, just being able to measure time increasingly accurately means you can better regulate work and workers. So people have to start work at a certain time. They have to work for a certain number of hours. Then there's hour striking, so that the clocks would have been ringing out with the bells the number of hours kind of on the hour. And before that, a lot of people wouldn't have actually been able to count. But when you're hearing the number of hours, you've got to be at work at a certain time, the pub's going to close at a certain time, that's encouraging everybody to be counting and thinking about the passing of time, the number, you know, the amount of time, the number of hours to go. And there's also a change in the type of hours that people used. So the church previous to that used seasonal hours, which varied with the seasons. So there was always 12 hours from sunrise to sunset, but the length of those hours varied depending on the time of year. But once you've got mechanical clocks measuring this sort of constant flow of time, then you've got equal hours. So that cut ties both with the church, so increasing secularization, but also cutting ties with nature as well. So it's the clocks now rather than the sun that are ruling time. And that abstract sort of measure of time, that abstract mathematical measure, that sort of concept of something divorced from nature, if you like, that is also thought to have bled through into other kinds of measures. So weights and distances, for example. So rather than measures that had some kind of basis in the real world, like a foot, for example, measures became much more standardized, sort of, and mathematical. And so that really changed from a sort of qualitative to a sort of quantitative way of thinking.
I should jump in and just say that there's an earlier, absolutely fascinating episode in the kind of crystallization of the movements of the heavens into mechanical form, in that you wrote a wonderful book about the Antikythera mechanism. Just briefly tell us a bit about that, because that really is an ancient marvel.
Yes, I love the Antikythera mechanism. So this is a bronze clockwork device that was found on a shipwreck, an ancient Greek shipwreck. So it's 2,000 years old, this thing, dozens of bronze gear wheels. It took a century for scientists to work out what on earth this was, but it turns out that it was a miniature mechanical universe, essentially. You turned a handle on the side and these gears were calculating the motions of the sun, moon and planets in the sky, so pointers showing you their position, moving positions in the sky. It predicted eclipses, it had a star calendar, so that's showing that view of the universe as a machine following mechanical rules sort of goes right back to the ancient Greeks. But what was different with clocks is that the Antikythera mechanism, you had to turn it by hand. But then once clocks were invented, then you had these models that could turn themselves.
So Martin, let me just bring you in. Jo's book is showing the kind of decoupling of humankind and the cosmos over a long period. How much do you think it is down to ingenuity and mechanisms like clocks? And how much do you think to the rise of the mathematical, the use of maths and the mathematical universe?
Well, I'd like to say that astronomy has always been at the spearhead of many exciting technologies, the need for time measurement. And of course, not only do we have the very early methods to measure time, but in the so-called dark ages of the monasteries in the 13th and 14th centuries, it's amazing how sophisticated they were. They measured the stars. They did this partly so that they could pray at the right times, but they followed these exactly. They already knew that the Julian calendar was getting a bit out of sync. And that was adjusted, of course, a few centuries later. So it was amazing how much they did at that time. Astronomy has always been at the spearhead of technology. On your question about the disconnect, this is one thing where I'm not sure I fully resonate with Jo, because I think that we are closer to the universe now than we ever were, rather than more disconnected, because at the time of all these discoveries, people had no idea what the stars were made of. They're the vault of heaven. They thought they were some fifth essence, not the same to the stuff as the Earth. Whereas we now know that the stars are like the sun. And I think the most amazing thing we've learned is that we are made of stardust. All the atoms that we are made of were synthesized from pristine hydrogen in stars that lived and died before the sun formed. So every one of us has inside us atoms which were created in stars all through the Milky Way 5 billion years or more ago. And so there's a more intimate link, I would say, in that sense, between the stars and us than was ever appreciated by the ancients. So in some sense, I agree with Jo, but I think this great idea, which goes back to Fred Hoyle and Margaret Burbidge and others in the 50s, is a real new perception, as important as what Darwin did.
I completely agree with that. I think there's sort of two different sides to this. So one is this incredible understanding that we have that no one had had before. Like you say, the fact that the elements that form our bodies were forged inside stars. You know, we can see further into the universe now than our senses ever could with the telescopes that we have. So, you know, all of these celestial events and objects that we know about. So we have this incredible connection in one sense, mm-hmm. and this intellectual understanding and the stories around that. So I do completely agree with that. But I think it's the sort of personal emotional connection, I suppose, that awe I was talking about at the beginning, and also just the technology of our modern lives, the fact that we have electric lights and heating, and you know, we can live in a way that's separate from, you know, from the sunrise and sunset, the season. So we can't really see the stars, and the phases of the moon, the passage of the sun is much less relevant to us now than it's ever been. So on the one side, we have this incredible connection, mm-hmm. but it's that sort of more physical and emotional connection that I think we're losing, that I'm also sort of interested in. Does that matter?
Yes, we don't navigate by the stars anymore, of course.
Newton came in though, didn't he? And he united the movements of the heavens, the objects in the heavens with cannonballs on Earth with his laws. One of the stars of our Science City gallery in the museum. And I think, Jo, let's hear another reading from the book, which I think goes into this.
Okay, so this is a reading about power. When Newton used a combination of observation and reasoning to show that the very same equations predicted the motion of everything in the cosmos, from apples to planets, from a grain of sand to the blazing sun, he transformed how people thought not just about the physical world, but about who they were and how they lived. What Newton came up with wasn't just gravity or action at a distance, it was a new system of the world. The ground had already been prepared. In the early 17th century, Galileo's telescope observations, showing that the sun had spots, the moon had mountains, and planets had their own phases and moons, started to break down the perceived division between the corrupt earth and divine, perfect heavens. Through his studies of motion, Galileo also came up with the fundamental idea that the universe is a mechanical system ruled not by God's will, but physical principles. Philosophy is written in this vast book, which lies continuously open before our eyes. I mean the universe, he wrote. It is written in the language of mathematics. These ideas about the cosmos greatly influenced political thinkers, such as the English philosopher Thomas Hobbes. Like Galileo, Hobbes believed in a mechanical, material cosmos, and he argued that all natural phenomena, even human thought, are simply the result of mechanical interactions between material bodies. In Leviathan, published in 1651, Hobbes applied these principles to politics and society, rejecting the divine right of kings and arguing that people are born equal. But he was still far from democratic. Without a strong power structure to hold them together, he saw individuals as analogous to chaotic particles bouncing about in a violent, anarchic state of nature in which there would be no technology, industry, arts, or science, and life would be solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short. To avoid this, he suggested, we must give up our individual rights in return for protection from a sovereign with absolute power. In 1687, Newton replaced this aimless cosmos with a greater plan. Far from being chaotic, he showed, celestial bodies are ruled by the universal law of gravitation. Almost immediately, philosophers and political theorists started to think about what that might mean for society. If a single mathematical law governs the entire universe, they figured, surely similar universal principles must also apply to people. So all through human history, ideas about the cosmos, how the universe works, have fed into political structures on Earth. So ancient civilizations, from the Mayans to the Babylonians to the Romans to the Chinese, rulers have borrowed divine authority from celestial bodies, and that worked very well for them. It's very hard to question someone's authority if it comes from the divine heavens, if it's just part of the way the universe works. But more recently, that different ideas about the universe have also fed through. So when Copernicus put the sun at the center of the solar system, for example, with the planets orbiting round, then European kings immediately started comparing themselves to the sun with their subjects orbiting around them like planets. But when Newton came along and sort of changed all that and showed that these universal laws of physics applied to everything in the universe, that really fed into ideas that the same laws should apply to all people as well, whether commoners or kings. And these Newtonian ideas were very influential for the sort of ideas about democracy and human rights that were being developed at the time. A lot of the sort of revolutionaries in America and France were really staunch Newtonians. And you see it in the language that was used, a lot of astronomical metaphors. So America, for example, was seen as a colony that was like a planet that was orbiting the central sun, which was England. And then after the American Revolution, when you had this newborn democracy, the United States, they had to come up with a new cosmic metaphor. There couldn't be a planet sort of orbiting a sun anymore. So they came up with the idea of the states as a constellation of equal stars. And so hence, when they were coming up with a flag, they represent the states with stars. So I think that's just a really nice example of how, you know, even today, the democracies that we have, that there's still that sort of cosmic ideas at the heart of them.
And of course, it also links with the idea of the body, the increasing perception of the body as a machine rather than something divine. And in fact, I think we've got an image of the silver swan, which is a wonderful robotic swan, actually famous for entrancing Mark Twain and many others. And it was one of the stars of our robots exhibition. And thank you to the Bowes Museum in County Durham for lending it to us. It is a spectacular, I've seen it cranked up and in action, and people are absolutely mesmerized by it even today. So Jo, just talk through a little bit about the rise of the thinking of the body as a machine.
Yeah, so we know even in ancient Greek times, there was this idea of, you know, we have the Antikythera mechanism showing the universe as a machine, and they had automata as well for animals and people. So that sort of principle of this sort of mechanical beings was there, but they wouldn't have seen them as just machines. I think a popular way of seeing it at the time would have been as the universe is infused with a kind of divine life force or soul. So machines, but not just machines. And then Descartes in the early 17th century kind of famously split mind and body, sort of matter and soul. And then I think what happened with Newton, that Marty can say more about this, but I imagine he would have been horrified by, was that his physics was so powerful at explaining what was happening in the universe that there was almost no need for a god or soul to sort of add to that. It was sort of, it could explain everything already. And so
To ask Martin about that. And in fact, I've got a few questions in for the audience, but before I get to those, Martin, Newton must have been quite conflicted because he was very religious as well. So how did he square that particular circle?
Well, I think he probably thought of God as a geometer, and he was disclosing the laws of God in the natural world. But I think the important point, and this follows up what Joe was saying, is that Newton was very lucky in that the phenomena he was discussing, the orbits of the moons and the planets, were among the very few things in the natural world that we can both understand and predict. There are many things we can understand but can't predict. The weather, for instance, and of course many, many more things that we can't even understand. So I think the fact was that he took, through luck, a part of nature which is exceptional in that it's predictable and understandable mathematically. And of course, this led other people to regard this as the archetype science, and to regard mechanical entities as being governed by Newton's laws, etc. We now know everything is much, much more complicated, and ideas of chaos means that we can't predict, even in principle, many important things, and it's much, much more complicated. So astronomy is, in a sense, a simple science, and it was lucky that that was the one that Newton was able to test with his laws, and of course that is why it had the huge cultural influence in the 18th century.
So we've got a few questions here from the audience, so let me try and pack in as many as possible in the next couple of minutes. There's one from Joseph. What do you think about Elon Musk's Starlink satellites? I must admit, I was gazing up the night sky and I saw a little train of them going ahead. But I'm right in thinking, aren't I, Martin, there's quite a lot of unease among astronomers about the night sky getting rather cluttered.
Well, that's right, because these spacecraft will move across the sky and they're as bright as many of the naked eye stars. And especially just after sunset and before sunrise, when the sun is still shining on them, they can certainly just distort a picture of the sky. So at least it's good that Musk company is trying to minimize the risk by painting them black, as it were, so they don't make too much effect. But they are, especially if there's a higher set of spacecraft, as has been discussed by some other companies, that they will impede some astronomical measurements, especially when you're scanning a sky to look for varial objects.
There's a question here from Jack, and I'm not sure, Joe or Martin, which of you'd like to comment on this, but they say, given that staycations are in fashion during the pandemic, could you recommend your favourite UK stargazing destination? Well, Martin, are you going to endorse a particular dark sky?
I am. Although it may not be the darkest place, one of my favourite places is Anglesey, on the west coast of Anglesey. Lovely, quiet places where you can see the stars fairly clearly. But in Northumberland, there, and also in the Brecon Beacons, there are areas which are designated as dark sky areas, and there's certainly a campaign to make other areas protected in that way.
And I was going to mention Northumberland, but I also want to just kind of put in a word for London, because I had always assumed that there wasn't really much point in trying to see the stars in London, but
you've got a lovely orange haze, don't you?
Exactly, but actually there is quite a lot you can see. I was looking at Sirius with the kids probably back in April, sparkling all the colours of the rainbow. It was fantastic, and you get a great view of Venus. And then a few weeks ago we kind of had a telescope party with some friends down our road, and we had the telescope set up in the middle of the road, and we saw the moons of Jupiter and the rings of Saturn through the telescope, and the children just thought it was wonderful. So, you know, even here in the middle of the city, there are just wonderful things to see in the sky.
A question from Alexandra for you, Joe. How does the changing night sky and light pollution affect animals and nature?
Yeah, this is something else I look at in the book, is the biological effects of the sunlight, also the moonlight as well, and that there are human effects on health that are turning out to be quite serious. But with nature, a couple of years ago, scientists said that we should see artificial light pollution as a global threat on a par with climate change. Like, it really is quite devastating for lots of different ecosystems. But the one sort of heartening thing, I would say, because there's so many things to worry about in terms of environmental degradation, light pollution is something we can just switch off. Like, we can reverse it really easily. You know, if we want to have something to feel like positive about, where we could actually make a difference, then campaigning for cleverer lighting systems that don't sort of leak out and affect wildlife, and whether that's sort of insects or birds navigating, sort of turtles, amphibians, it's every sort of aspect, every part of the animal kingdom, that is something that we could do and make a difference really quickly.
Another question here from Emma. And perhaps you could both quickly answer. There's been an explosion of science fiction movies and literature going back to the latter part of the 20th century, all the way up to now. Do you think our fascination with the stars is as strong today as it ever was?
I think it's getting stronger because, as I say, we understand how we're related to the stars. We have close-up pictures of the planets of our solar system. Even more exciting, we know that there are billions of stars in our galaxy orbited by retinues of planets like the Earth. And within 10 years, we'll be able to perhaps find evidence for a biosphere on some of those planets. So it's far more exciting. And so all these things, along with developers like AI, I would have thought to stimulate interest in science and give new ideas to science fiction.
I think it's just as strong. Oh, sorry, Roger.
You know, I guess you'd say the fascination is more of a subject, but please answer.
So I was going to say, I think it's just as strong, but it's different, because now we can get a lot of our fascination from the stars through through books and our screens and TV. So we're getting this incredible knowledge about the universe. But I think just the lack of major outcry over the fact that the stars are disappearing, that our view of the cosmos we're part of is being wiped away, shows you that we don't care as much about that personal connection with the stars. We're kind of happy to experience that through our screens. And I do, you know, it's wonderful, the new perspective that we have, but I do feel sorry for that loss of that direct experience.
I think for the last section, we've got about 10 minutes to go until the end. There's a wonderful image, an iconic image, Earthrise, taken by Apollo 8, which I think, triggered this idea of the pale blue dot. That was obviously Sagan and Voyager and so on. The Earth as being a vulnerable place, our home and so on. Martin, you've been very vocal in the past about the importance of non-human spaceflight. For instance, in your book on the future, you would prefer to see robots and humans in space. And I guess, do you see where Joe's coming from, that astronomers are taking the magic and mystery out of the cosmos?
Yes. Well, first, let me say that I think that is an iconic image, as we know, because it has been iconic for environmentalists ever since. But I think that was taken by one of the Apollo astronauts, as you know. And the Apollo program was a huge program funded by the Americans with 4% of their federal budget in order to get to the moon before the Russians. When that success was achieved, of course, the budget was cut. Otherwise, there'd have been footprints on Mars long before today. So manned space flight, or as you call it, men and women in space, we must not be sexist on this, have been up to the space station, but it's not so glamorous going round and round the Earth in low orbit. The space station only made news when Chris Hadfield played his guitar and sang David Bowie songs, or when the Lou didn't work or something like that. Space flight has not been very glamorous since then. And the practical case for it has got weaker because robots and miniaturization have got far better. So one can send out probes to the outer planets and get lots of data. And it's true that a geologist would find things on Mars that the present probes couldn't find, but soon an artificial intelligent probe would be able to do that sort of thing. So given that it's so expensive to send people into space, I don't think if I was an American taxpayer, or it is a European taxpayer, I would support manned space flights. Crew space flight is the term one should use. And the reason is that if civilians are being sent at public expense into space, you've got to be risk averse. The Americans had two failures in 135 launches of the shuttle, and each was a very big trauma in America. So my line is that there should be no publicly funded space flight because there's no practical case, but we should cheer on Mr. Elon Musk and Mr. Bezos for their companies, which can launch adventures into space, and they can do it more cheaply, not because of the Silicon Valley technology, but because they can accept higher risks. They can launch into space the kind of people prepared to take a much bigger risk than the public can impose on publicly funded civilians. And so I do hope that there will be some adventurers in the mold of Sir Ranulph Fiennes and people like that who will go to the moon. And I think the first people on Mars, and I hope there will be some by the end of the century, will be people like that with one-way tickets. And of course, Elon Musk has said himself that he wants to die on Mars, but not on impact. I think he's 49 years old, so he might make it. So I think we should cheer on those who are privately sponsored, and are prepared to take high risks and do it more cheaply, but not spend huge public fortunes on sending people into space.
Can I disagree a little bit?
Sorry, go on, Joe, you please.
I think that the cultural impact of us going into space has been so great. And that a lot of that was because it wasn't machines exploring, it was people. And I think that Earthrise picture is a really good example, because there's a lovely story behind how that was taken, where the three Apollo astronauts that were all staring down at the surface of the moon, they had this black and white film in their camera, sort of taking pictures of the surface of the moon, and then looked up and saw this view of Earthrise. And there's audio of them talking, saying, Where's the colour film? Quick, grab it. We've got to get a picture of that. It wasn't part of their original mission. And it was that when they saw it, they instinctively knew that that was an important image, and they scrambled to get the colour film and take the picture. And if we'd just had machines up there, they would have just followed their initial instructions. And astronauts generally, you know, they're sort of sent up there with their missions, and then there's this phenomenon of the overview effect, where they come back sort of passionate and poetic about our Earth, you know, talking about the Earth as this fragile haven. Often they talk about it as a living being, come back saying how important it is that we protect it, how important, you know, how trivial sort of our terrestrial conflicts are, how we're all sort of flying on the same spaceship, as I think Chris Hadfield put it. So that's a sort of example of, you know, that wasn't the reason that they went up. There's that phrase of, well, we went into space to discover the moon, and actually we discovered the Earth. And that was a human perspective. That was from people looking down and having that sort of awe change how they thought. And that those photos have been so influential in encouraging the sort of the green movement, for example, and in changing how we think about our relationship to our planet. So yes, we have to think about the costs and the risks, but I think it's not just the sort of practical side, that there is an importance in having a sort of experience, a sort of a conscious person up there, if you see what
I agree. I mean, you can get those pictures. They could be taken by robots now.
Yeah, but would it have been? Because that wasn't the plan. The plan was to take pictures of the moon's surface, and then it was when they looked up and realised that they changed the plan and took that picture.
No, it's
robots have advanced. That's the difference. And I hope there will be crazy risk-taking adventurers who will do this. It's just that it's so expensive to send people if you have to make their journeys safe. Mm-hmm. And the phrase space tourism shouldn't be used. It should be space adventure, which is highly risky.
Oh, I like that. That's nice.
But Joe, I mean, if you look at the headlines in the last couple of months, you know, we've seen fires in the Arctic. We've seen extinction at an unprecedented rate. We've seen an orange haze over San Francisco, like something from the set of Blade Runner. How important, how much do you think rekindling this sort of visceral connection with the cosmos could help us take better care of our planet?
I think it's vital. Some of the researchers who work on the awe, so that work I was mentioning before, have talked about a problem of awe deprivation. So they think in modern society, with our sort of disconnection from nature, when we're not confronted with that sort of vastness of reality that dwarfs us, that we, you know, we're focused down on these little screens, and then they've argued that that's responsible for us becoming sort of more selfish, more narcissistic, more materialistic, and that we sort of need a dose of awe to give us that bigger perspective, to realize that we're all connected to something bigger, and that how our actions sort of affect the planet. So we absolutely need, you know, logical, rational thought and science to help us with the climate crisis. We need to understand what the situation is. We need to come up with solutions to that. So that's absolutely vital. But I think also we're going to need a dose of awe to give us that bigger picture, and to give us the, you know, the motivation to get out of our sort of daily terrestrial materialistic lives and make the changes that are necessary to live more sustainably on this planet.
I must say, I find it fascinating that just with your, as with your last book, Cure, you're making a passionate argument about putting subjectivity back into science. And you even flirt towards the end of your latest book with a slightly wacky sounding idea of cosmopsychism. How's that idea gone down with scientists, Joe? Is that subjectivity that's gone a little bit too far, perhaps?
Well, what I'm interested in the end of the book is just looking at different ideas for how reality might be, because the sort of the physics framework as we have it at the moment is this sort of mathematical framework, and we can explain sort of particles and forces, but we can't explain yet consciousness. And so there are, you know, schools of thought, some philosophers would argue that we need to see consciousness as a fundamental part of reality, not as a sort of supernatural thing, but just a fundamental part of the reality that science describes. And there are also some quantum physicists, especially followers of the physicist John Wheeler, who would argue that, you know, he had this idea of a participatory universe, that rather than a big bang and then going through billions of years and then sort of life arises and we arise, that actually the universe is being created in billions upon billions of sort of tiny creative flashes as we experienced it. So it was more just saying that idea of a sort of inert physical universe out there and us as some kind of passive observers just sort of measuring what's happening isn't the only way of seeing reality. There are lots of other different ways. And I do think we need to find ways of thinking about consciousness and our own experience and making that important. And so, yeah, in Cure, I was saying that our minds are important in health, which has been seen as a very wacky idea. You know, lots of scientists have been very skeptical, you know, obviously our thoughts can't affect our bodies, but actually now we're realizing that they can, and we need to find ways of studying that and understanding that and incorporating that into medicine. So I'm really just saying the same thing for our understanding of reality, that we should be able to accept our sort of own experience as being important as well. And I would be surprised if scientists had a particular problem with that.
Well, I think, sadly, there's some other questions from Lindsay and Julia. Forgive me, guys, I don't think we got time to do them. But one last question for you both, because obviously you've been looking at the human cosmos. And I guess in the week that we've been talking about phosphine in the clouds of Venus, and there's lots of excitement about Venusians and so on, I'm a bit skeptical, I have to say. What about the alien cosmos? That's another mind-boggling way that science has changed our perspective about our place in the universe. Martin, what do you make of that? And then last word to Joe.
Well, of course, it's quite like many people think there's going to be some life which we find evidence for, some sort of biospheres around these other planets, whether it'll be intelligent life and whether it'll be flesh and blood or electronic, we don't know, but it's worth a search. There's far more out there than we know. But going back and touching base with what Joe just said, I think we've got to accept that astronomy is a simple science, and all these features about consciousness and indeed life in general may be too hard for human brains to explain. And so the wonder and the mystery is going to be always with us. and that's something we can share with each other and which we share with the earlier generations who Jo writes about in her early chapters. So most of the universe is still mysterious and maybe always will be.
Jo, final word to you.
Yeah, I think it's really interesting, the news this week, and it's interesting how far back ideas about aliens go. The ancient Greeks were enthusiastically talking about the idea of aliens on other worlds, and there's kind of been a pendulum since then. There have been certain times when aliens was just seen as, you know, beyond the pale, you couldn't even talk about it, and other times through history when people have been very enthusiastic about it. So it seems that we're now, you know, coming into a more optimistic period. But I think for me, whether or not we find aliens, what's fascinating about the search for alien life is that it's showing us how sort of Earth-centric we often are in our ideas about life. So it's just really stretching our ideas about where you could find life and what life itself is. For me, that's the really interesting thing about this.
Well, that sadly is all that we've got time for. So do rush out and buy copies of Martin's new edition of Gravity's Fatal Attraction. Of course, do also order a copy of the wonderful The Human Cosmos. I should add that we've also got other events in the works. Let me just point out just two. Brian May, who Martin and I were grilling last year in the Science Museum IMAX, he's publishing his Cosmic Clouds 3D on September the 23rd. You can visit our website for details. Another great friend of the museum, astronaut Tim Peake, will discuss his upcoming autobiography, Limitless, on October the 15th. Just visit Penguin Live for details. And finally, thank you so much for those questions. Thank you, Martin. Thank you, Jo, and good night all.